So this is a photograph of Jack at the Glenburn Potteries in Avondale, sort of late 1960s. He's going through, I guess it looks to be the remnants of a machinery floor, and so potentially there's, you know, you've got bearings, you've got metal objects, you've got pieces of equipment that would have formed part of bigger pieces of machinery that were used in the production of the potteries and the ceramics at the site. What's interesting about Jack is that he was doing this as an amateur historian. He wasn't professional. He was working as well as doing this type of site-based work and going out and exploring. And so for him, this was just a fragment really of over 40 years of research and exploring and going out and documenting what the history of the West was and the history of these industries. And so, yeah, this image is just a snapshot, obviously, of a much, much broader body of work. This volume here is place names of the Waitakere city. There's an entry here for Pukiaruhe Stream. The stream flows down from below Pukiaruhe Pa, situated on the ridge above the Opunuku Stream. The Pukiaruhe Pa was one of the few inland pa in the Waitakere Ranges. This is great because it's possibly the only comprehensive document of the origins of the names of the streams and the tracks in the Waitakere Ranges. This is a Waitemata City catchment plan. So he's gone through and researched about the sites, about the geography, about the social history of those sites, about the connections to the communities that lived there, and created names based on that. So in a way, it's quite an authentic representation of the life that was happening in the Waitakere's at the time. The official sort of result of all of that work that he's done. It's been sort of transcribed onto this map and is now an official record.
When Dad was only about 14, he and Tom and Brian would cycle on bicycles from Morningside out to Bethels and camp there in the weekend and come back again. Some of those early trips out to Piha in particular, they stayed in the old mill houses there. And those happened to be covered with newspapers on the walls for warmth and that sort of thing. So if it was wet and that, they'd be reading the newspapers. I think that sort of got his interest going in history and that. And he realised that, you know, the mill houses wouldn't be there for much longer. The mill had closed down the years before, of course. And once they'd gone, history would disappear. Here is my sister and myself, Judith. We were on a Nikau branch in the stream with Dad pulling us down there. That was one of our earlier trips there, which was, you know, one of the exciting places that we got to and different things that we did. One of myself, probably about 10 or 12 or 14 years old, in a stream, obviously with a big piece of ironwork, which is part of an old timber dam. Sort of seeing remnants like that were pretty exciting to us as well. Very interesting to see myself there. I'd quite forgotten that trip.
This is an example of a timber dam, the type that Jack was researching in the Waitakere's. This one is on the Opunuku Stream. There's not a lot of it remaining by the look of it, so you've just got the sort of two cross beams there as part of the main sort of superstructure, but obviously they're still having an effect on the water and the stream and holding it back. This is a survey of the Kauri timber dams and bush tramways in the Waitakere's. So this is from a period between 1953 and 1978. This is his book plate that he had printed. So it says from the library of John T. Diamond. You've got your sort of your end papers and then you're back into the handwritten text, which is quite lovely. So this is just an example of a site plan that he's drawn of a holding dam. So he's drawn the Opunuku Stream and drawn the structures of the mill and how it operates, and got a really nice example of the water wheel that's behind the dam. He just was so interested in how things worked, like how things were made. How did this come to be? but also it was just quite awe-inspiring. Something as simple as a timber dam, but it had such a devastating purpose. It was culling timber at a huge rate and moving it around and using it to build New Zealand. But there's so much attention to detail, and I think that really says something about his personality and his dedication to providing a faithful record of what he was seeing.
When I was in the Scouts, we actually built some early kayaks. And later on, after we'd finished using them, Mum and Dad used to go out. That was in the brickworks phase when Dad was plotting all of the brickworks around in the area. And a lot of them you could only really get to up some of the inlets because that's where the ships had loaded the bricks onto and so on. And so, yeah, they spent quite a few years using these kayaks to do all those sorts of trips. The one I've got here is Dad going down into one of the flumes underneath the kilns, which I think from memory carried the heat in that to heat up the kilns. So Mum took all the photographs of Dad doing things in the brickworks. They never had any other people there. And so it was quite an extensive time of research for Dad. And Mum very ably helped him, as she did all the way through with his earlier trips and so on. She was always there to assist Dad.
So this is Jack's diamond method of identifying and classifying New Zealand bricks prior to 1930. His opening line is, "I am more aware than any other person how inadequate, unreliable and virtually useless is my system, but because of the complete lack of any other system suitable for New Zealand, I have prepared this guide as I believe it is better to be able to identify 10 or even 5 products out of 100 using this system than none at all." So he's got radials, he's got squints, splays, bullnose and plinth bricks, but they've also got their own interesting names like single, stretcher, header, beveled, bats. I had no idea there were so many, but this is a bound volume Jack has produced on the Crum Brick and Tile Pottery Co. So this is a survey that he did in 1983. He sort of said, "This room built of wood is situated 8 metres away from the north ends of number 2 and number 3 kilns, 7.5 metres from the east side of number 5 and 32 metres from number 1 and the zigzag kilns." So he goes into this level of detail about the geography of a site, which is really quite interesting. This is a photo of the quarry at Amalgamated Brick and Pipe in New Lynn. Even up when I was living around that area as a child back in the 70s, the chimneys were always a bit of a landmark to people who lived in that area, and so it's just amazing to look at this photo and see what was there then and see what is there now. It's really quite incredible. Quite a special photo in my opinion.
So we're standing in front of Ambrico Kiln, built in 1926 by Ethel Miller, but everything was demolished, that the industry had come to an end, and it was local people. It was people like Jack Diamond. They got together and really lobbied to try and get this kiln to survive. It's the last kiln of its type in Auckland, which talks about a much bigger industry. And to me, it's kind of exciting because you don't see it, and it's really unexpected when you come for a walk to find this remnant here. Jack didn't just collect stories. He also collected some artifacts, and he collected bricks. And so he would make friends with the guys at the brickyards, and he would make friends with the security guards, and they would look out for bits and pieces for him. And so he collected bricks from all over New Zealand, and certainly from all over Auckland. And those bricks are now in the collection of Te Tō Uku, the Clay Museum.
This is a document that Jack put together in 1979, and it's titled My Research, How It Was Conducted and My Observations. And I really love this because for a change, we really get Jack speaking about Jack. "So you are using my notes for your research. I trust you will find them useful, but before you pass judgment on them, please consider these points regarding this collection." He thought, there was just very little interest in local history, and to him, that was the reason why he had to start doing the work that he did, because nobody else was really doing it, because they just didn't think that it was significant or important. And so for him to start doing that work, to document what he could see around him, was really important.
It's not just a collection of photographs. It might be a photograph of Dr. Stoppard's house. You would also have in the archive the plan of the house that he made. And you might have his field notes. And then he's gone and done some research on Dr. Stoppard. So he's gone through the Herald and he's found some advertisements. So people can really understand and get the context. It's an absolutely extraordinary collection, and I think being able to make all those connections and putting things into context is one of the things that makes it really, really rich.
He belonged to the anthropology department of the university and the archaeology department as well. Those students were at the university studying, and they'd come to Dad asking for information, and he led quite a few of them into their careers because of all the information he had collected and could make available to him. He very freely gave away information. He didn't manage to sort of have a degree himself, but he felt that he'd helped so many others. It was almost like having a degree. He didn't finish it. He was recognised, of course, with an MBE for his research, which was a great honour, and he felt that was a recognition for what he might have missed out by not having a degree.
As part of my involvement with the collection and being the archivist here, we were given the opportunity to submit an application to the UNESCO Memory of the World Register. That was in 2017, and happily it was accepted, and so Jack's collection is now part of the Memory of the World Register. It was quite a sweet, I guess, bookend to working with Jack's collection. It's a nice acknowledgement of the work that he did, and recognising that even though he was a self-professed amateur, he was able to capture something that hadn't been done by anybody else and is now a really valuable part of our story, or the story of West Auckland. So we're really lucky to have it.